Welcome back to our ninth installment or module of the Citizens Pension Academy. Our topic is how to measure the depth of the pension flood in any town. Up in the Springfield headwaters of Oak Brook's public safety pension systems, the legislators who rubber stamp what the public safety unions draft and the governors who sign the stuff don't care how deep the resulting flood of pension spending gets in any downstream town, and what happens to those towns swamped by unfunded pension liabilities, drowning out all other competing spending programs and public priorities. No one in Springfield even measures it, but we can. On one hand, we could trace the GASB 68 math that each town must put on its balance sheet, but we can also go directly to where the flood of spending shows up as revenue levies that apply to the equalized assessed value, or EAV, of all the private real estate in a town. Levy is a very appropriate word for this, because remember, Led Zeppelin was only a band for 2 years when the 1970 Illinois Constitution started this flood. When the Levy Breaks was on their fourth album that came out November 8, 1971. When the Levy Breaks is a country blues song written and first recorded by Kansas Joe McCoy and Memphis Minnie in 1929. The lyrics reflect experiences during the upheaval caused by the Great Mississippi Flood of 1927. Here is the levy chart for all 34 towns in DuPage County. These are the levy amounts for police and fire pensions. A column for a levy, column for the rate, column for the revenue. They levy what they need in revenue, and they translate it into a rate, and apply that to the equalized assessed value of your real estate. And then you make arguments to your assessor why your equalized assessed value should be lower than your neighbor's, in your vain attempt to lower the tax pressure caused by fire and police pension spending. Levies are a symptom of the pressure that unfunded pension obligations put on a town. Unfunded means no one paid it, so it piles up as a debt behind a levy that holds back the debt until it can be collected from the real estate owners upon whom it is imposed. This is what Oak Brook does not do, but almost everyone else does. In general, you can look up the per capita amount of debt in any town in Illinois using this taxpayer dashboard at www.taxpayerdashboard.com, operated by Statistax LLC. Here is Illinois, for example. As Chief Justice John Marshall pointed out a long time ago, the power to tax is the power to destroy, and that is exactly what public safety pension debt does to real estate. The taxpayer dashboard is a tool to tell you where to live and where not to live, based on how much water pressure is built up behind the levy of spending that has to be paid for in destructive taxes. You want to invest in real estate that will not be swamped by those taxes. Unlike John Maynard Keynes and his arcane national income equations dedicated to pretending that more government spending is stimulative and good for you, the Statistax equations are designed to reveal the depressive effect of all this government spending on your real estate values. RPC is revenue per capita in a town. SPC is spending per capita. DBPC is debt burden per capita, and then the growth rate of both spending and debt growth are factored in by these equations. Data that these units of government already report to the U.S. Government Census Bureau is then churned through these equations. We also calculate total fiscal liability per capita, as well as the number of government employees per capita in any given town, to get to the root of what drives the spending and how that impacts the level of flooding in that town's branch of the Illinois Pension River. This data then gets ported by zip code so that you can type in your address and see how bad things might be where you live. Here is Oak Brook, for example, showing a debt per capita of $468. This includes things like park district and school debt, as well as pension debt. You see that in Oak Brook, revenue per capita is greater than spending per capita. This shows that Oak Brook is not under insane spending pressure, which means it's a desirable place to live. And we still have seen how non-public safety spending in Oak Brook has been crimped and limited by the pension obligations, taking up 50% of all new sales tax revenue since 2005. Now let's look at Park Forest, Illinois. Here's part of their GASB 68 disclosure, which is very opaque compared to how it could be. We see a pattern unlike Oak Brook, where here in Park Forest, the police fund is being underfunded by over $200,000 in 2020. Here's the Park Forest fire pension math, again showing underfunding. See the middle column where it says contribution excess or deficiency. Back to the Park Forest Police Fund, we see that 2020 pension liability started at $36,172,102, and then in spite of paying $1.8 million, their pension liability still grew to $37,742,629 by year end. So Park Forest is going backwards. In hydraulic language, this would be called prolapse, where the liquid flows backwards. So you get when you have congestive heart failure. The fund is filling up with debt faster than revenue can pay it. And they are 50% funded and getting worse, not better. Same thing with Park Forest Fire Fund. They throw in $1.1 million during 2020, and by year end, they owe a net additional $829,815 than when they started in 2020. So again, this is sort of a pension prolapse they've got going on. Now let's look at Harvey, Illinois. Here's the taxpayer dashboard for Harvey. Spending per capita exceeds revenue per capita, and debt per capita is higher than revenue per capita. This tells you that the Illinois pension river runs deep through Harvey. As the Illinois policy study of October 6, 2021 points out, what most towns are paying now is simply debt, and now less than 50 cents of every additional real estate tax dollar since 1996 goes to actual services. The rest goes to just debt, and most of that is driven by the Illinois Pension Code that operates under the protection of the Illinois Constitution. See revenue per capita, $2,095. Spending per capita, $2,409. Debt per capita, $2,537, which is higher than the revenue per capita. Here's the Harvey Police Pension Fund math. The last year they disclosed is 2018 when they owed $1.9 million, but they only paid $735,000, leaving $1.2 million to pile up as more debt. Same thing with Harvey's Fire Fund. They shorted the 2018 payment by $891,282. They only paid 33% of what the bill really was. As a result, the police fund debt grew from $44.3 million to $45.9 million during 2018. And fire's debt grew from $62.7 million to $64.6 million. Even the Cook County Assessor has expressed alarm about what's happening. This is from Crane's June 7, 2021. Now, she did some interesting math to apply the overall debts of a town to certain buildings in that same town. The Sears Tower, for example, is swamped by $289 million of attributed debt burden, as she calculates it, which any buyer has to consider against the otherwise assessed value of $697 million for that property. So if you do the math, 41% of the assessed value of that property really isn't there because it's all going to go to pay that share of allocated debt. And sophisticated buyers certainly make those calculations. Here is Maria Pappas's map of Cook County with color coding to show which towns are the deepest underwater, with debt to property values between 38.5% and 48.1%. And you can see Park Forest is right there with 34%. Interestingly, Rosemont's in bad shape too because of all their debt. They've got a tremendous amount of debt in Rosemont. Pappas points out that more debt means more taxes. And here's her quote. "The idea behind this is for people to begin to understand that when they purchase a piece of real estate in Cook County, they're also purchasing a long-term credit card." Pappas also demonstrates that real estate taxes in Park Forest over 30 years will pay twice the amount of the market value of those homes in real estate taxes. Other towns are worse. In just 20 years, you would pay twice as much in taxes as the market value of your home in Riverdale, Fort Heights, Country Club Hills, or Harvey. And we know that the Illinois Constitution says that the fire and police pension elements of those taxes may never be reduced, but will be increased each time the Illinois General Assembly juices up the benefits by amending the pension code. Diabolically, this means that the areas hardest hit by unpayable pension spending driving higher and higher taxes are Black and Latino suburbs, identified by the Chicago Tribune in this August 17, 2021 news story. This makes it harder for Black and Latino families to accumulate generational wealth, says reporter Hal Dardick, who was actually on my Little League baseball team in River Forest 50 years ago. Most of that increased tax burden goes to fire and police pensions. And our source here is the Illinois Policy Group, September 1, 2021, in a released study called Suburban Residents Risk Losing Homes Over Rising Pension Costs. And they calculate that in Cook County from 1999 to 2019, 76% of the additional property tax dollars were spent on municipal police, and 74% of additional property tax were spent on municipal firefighters. And that went to pensions rather than to public safety costs. Didn't go to fire trucks, didn't go to boots, didn't go to training classes. 76% went to pensions for the police, and 74% of the additional money for the fire went to pensions. Same thing up in Lake County, according to this 10-year analysis. And again, this is from Illinois Policy in 2021. They calculate that in Cook County, residents actually saw funding to fire departments cut by $1.3 million, while the funding for the pensions increased by $13.8 million from 1999 to 2019. So we usually talk about how fire and police pensions crowd out spending for other programs of government, but it even works inside the fire department budgets themselves, where the non-pension part for equipment and anything else but pensions has been cut in Lake County, while pension spending has exploded. And in fact, in Lake County, only 19% of municipal property tax dollars raised for the fire department actually goes to protecting the community from fires. And again, here's that pie chart showing that in Lake County, most of the public safety spending pie actually goes to pensions rather than protection. As Adam Schuster of the Illinois Policy Group notes, quote, "The pension problem is starting to change the way local governments operate." So that's how you measure the depth of the Illinois pension river in any town, by looking at how they offload the unpayable debts of their pension onto the private real estate with calculations of levies and EAVs. The same thing will happen here in Oak Brook if we run out of sales tax and watch the pension river rise to swamp our private, residential, and commercial real estate. That nightmare scenario should be firmly before us each time we have a meeting to approve item 6B and our extra payroll expense needed to make the payments dictated by the Illinois Pension Code as part of per capita spending that hopefully will stay below per capita revenue without any appreciable debt that will seep out to swamp our real estate. And as we look out over the waters of our pension match calculations, we can measure the depth of our match that already runs 500% deeper than the corresponding burden on our employees who will receive all that pension money for as long as they may live. Oak Brook and its employees are pledged to that for as long as we both may live. But like a marriage, it ends when one party dies. Some of these towns we've looked at are about dead, and others are terminal. Rational people recoil at the cost of inelastic real estate prices that only go up, and depopulation only increases the burden of those who linger in those towns before fleeing or dying. This is how civilizations collapse. It's certainly how Illinois is collapsing. In the midst of this, is it fair to judge the public pension market only on its own internal terms, by the iron logic of the pension code and the Constitution? Should we make a comparative value judgment with reference to the private sector that pays for these public pensions? Tune in next time and we will switch perspectives and look at pensions in the private sector to evaluate the claim that public employees need super generous pensions to keep parity with private sector employees. See you then, Tuesday, December 7, 2021 at 7 p.m.